Do you also think this extraordinary hush-hush is necessary?
Yes, sir, I certainly do. I don't think there's a police force in the world that could handle the panic if the people found out these babies were loose.
Gentlemen, I believe we are ready. Now, some of you have displayed incredulous attitudes towards our reports and photographs. The rest of you are trying to understand the gravity of our situation, but repeatedly ask how really serious it is. Now, for your edification, I've prepared a short film, which I hope will give you some idea of the nature of the creatures we're up against. In a small way, of course. Robert, please turn out the lights. Now, these ants and related species are common to most of America. As a matter of fact, you can find them in backyards, empty lots, and fields throughout the temperate zones of the world. They haven't changed in either form or habits for more than 50 million years. Here, for instance, is one such specimen that got himself trapped in amber, which we know is at least that old. Ah, now we come to some different kinds of ants. The big fellow there, feeding on the smaller red grease eaters, is of a savage species called Camponotus bicinus meyer. He's of a desert variety, very similar to the giant mutations we found in New Mexico. There is a side view of a small nest. Those white objects are ant eggs. Ants don't see well at all. They hear, smell, and locate objects entirely with their radar-like antennae. Only after food or an enemy is located with the antennae are the savage mandibles put to work. Now, gentlemen, watch this demonstration of power. A pebble has blocked the entrance to the nest. That creature is determined to remove the obstacle. Note how the mandibles are used to grasp the pebble and finally pull it aside with only a slight assist from another ant. Now, there's the same pebble on a laboratory scales. Balancing it is a dish containing 20 ants. We've learned that one of these quarter-inch-long insects can lift 20 times its own weight. And that's equal to one of you lifting a ton and a half or more. And here are rare shots of a newborn queen and her consorts. Technically, she should be referred to as a princess until after the mating flight. Now, there is a close shot of a winged male. The males are unequipped for survival beyond the mating and die soon afterwards. The queen flies on, or more precisely, is borne by the winds until her need prompts her to seek a place to lay eggs.
Does a queen ever fly away from her nest once she's established it?
No, never. She loses her wings after the wedding flight. See, one has dropped off now. Now she starts her function of establishing a place in which to lay her eggs and begin the nest. Queens live quite a long time. They continue to lay eggs from the one mating for from 15 to 17 years. Here are ants at war. As you can see, ants are savage, ruthless, and courageous fighters. This fight lasted 72 hours between those two alone. Ants are the only creatures on Earth, other than man, who make war. They campaign, they are chronic aggressors, and they make slave laborers of the captives they don't kill. None of the ants previously seen by man were more than an inch in length, most considerably under that size. But even the most minute of them have an instinct and talent for industry, social organization, and savagery that makes man look feeble by comparison.
How large were the ants you found?
Oh, the smallest measured 9 feet in body length. That, gentlemen, is why you are here, to consider this problem, and I hope solve it. Because unless you solve it, unless these queens are located and destroyed before they've established thriving colonies and can produce heaven alone knows how many more queen ants, man, as the dominant species of life on Earth, will probably be extinct.